Before we begin, I'd like to thank Jason Scott for his work on Bbs the Documentary. Released in 2005, it serves as a magnificent record of the bulletin board era. It's now released under Creative Commons, and I'll be using a few clips from it in this episode. I'm sure most of us used pkzip and pkunzip during the 90s to compress and decompress our files. Written by Phil Katz, the zip format quickly became the standard for IBM PC compatibles. But there's a bitter backstory to this, and to explore it, we first have to start in 1952. Yes, in 1952, David A. Huffman, whilst studying information theory at MIT, wrote a paper on finding the most efficient binary code. His paper sacrificed speed for size and gave us a standard method of data compression. Explained very quickly, it cuts up all the usual bytes of data, assigns them onto a binary tree in descending order of frequency used, and then, by providing a means of unraveling the data, depending on which side of the tree it falls, allows each character to take up less than the usual 8 bits, or 1 byte, than it normally would. Fast forward to the 80s, and with bulletin board systems becoming ever more popular, it's abundantly clear that there needs to be a more efficient method of transporting files over the tediously slow and expensive system of modem-to-modem communication. Enter Tom Henderson and Andy Foray, who in the early 80s would set up a computing consultancy they would later name Software Enhancement Associates, or SEA for short, operating out of New Jersey. With both these gents having a background in the Merchant Navy, this became an integral part of the logo. Their work began really just helping out with the bulletin boards emerging at the time. FidoNet, a worldwide computer network used for communication between bulletin boards, was then in its infancy, and so Tom and Andy began making software to help it expand. They worked on the software Sea Dog, set up the Kitten BBS, and really enabled FidoNet to expand exponentially through work on their mailer software and Echo Mail, enabling a store and forwarding messaging system similar to Usenet. But their real breakthrough was creating a program called ARC in 1985, a compression utility which lent heavily from Huffman's freely published work. Distributed as shareware, this software quickly became the de facto standard for compression and decompression, not just on bulletin board systems, but also on MS-DOS and other business-related machines. In line with the accepted etiquette from his previous work on mainframes, Tom would also make the source code for the software completely available. There were rival products also in the marketplace, including Zoo, which was distributed freely and developed by Rahul Desi. This was another program developed from scratch and gained some traction, but despite being free, ARC was generally faster and offered better compression rates. Of course, ARC was also free, but as shareware, requested that users pay for the software if they continued to use it, or used it in a commercial sense. Given that the shareware model was relatively new at this point, in contrast to what you'd expect now, a fair few people in the BBS scene actually took a dislike to SEA. Some people felt that these were the tactics of a huge company coming in and commercializing a scene that was mostly made up of volunteers. Of course, unbeknownst to them, SEA was a family business made up of Tom's wife, Irene, Andy, and a single employee they had brought on to help with development. SEA essentially took the instigation flak for serving up a friendly model that vast companies would soon be built upon. Of course, not everyone felt like this, with many users paying their shareware fee and even sending fan mail to SEA, thanking them for developing the software that was saving them a bomb in telephone charges. Enter PKware, operated by Phil Katz, and seemingly out to take SEA's market share by offering PKARC, an ARC-compatible program which actually ran faster and offered a slightly cheaper model, especially if you were a corporation seeking a commercial license. In Jason Scott's Bbs documentary, various members of FidoNet were interviewed about its appearance, and Tom Henderson's initial reaction.
Directly opposite your ad is an ad for PK Arc. Quote, the other Arc program, close quote.
Yeah.
Dead silence on the other end. And finally he said, say that again. And I read it back to him again. So he went out and got a copy of the magazine and looked it up. And oh, he was mad.
In 1980, Phil Katz had enrolled on the computer science program at the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee, and immediately started writing programs, spending a lot of free time on bulletin board systems. His strength seemed to lay in creating highly optimized code, getting the job done with the fewest number of instructions and therefore running time. Shortly after, he went to work for Graysoft, a nearby software company, and in 1986 he had decided to set up his own business, PKware, releasing PK Arc shortly after. Now, whereas SEA's Arc was written in C, PK was partially written in assembly language, and the compression algorithms were implemented in a way to make them incredibly fast when compared to anything previous. This was important, especially for slower 80s PC hardware, which bulletin board operators needed to be executing other activities rather than just compression and decompression. The decompression utility, PKZark, was released as a free utility, allowing end users to decompress anything they had downloaded, meaning it was only people or bulletin boards wanting to compress files who needed to pay for the additional PK compression tool. Its speed meant it would quickly spread among users, especially given it could operate with exactly the same file format as SEA's software. The compression part, PK Arc itself, was released as shareware shortly after, with SEA of course having both taken the brunt and paved the way for this business model.
And we all switched. We all just kind of ran over to him. It never occurred to me that there might have been something going on there, and I'm still not sure that there was.
From Phil's perspective, he had done nothing wrong. He had taken readily available code, improved upon it, and sent it out into the wild. Doing so brought him a much higher income than his work at Graysoft, and so he quit, operating PKware from his mum's kitchen table. Another former Graysoft programmer, Steve Berg, was quickly brought on board to help with ongoing development.
At the time, I was just following accepted practices of this is how to make a living doing this stuff.
Well,
you know, this is what you do. You publish it. You declare copyright. Somebody infringes you. You send a cease and desist letter. Suing wasn't their first choice.
SEA had tried to smooth things out with Katz beforehand. In December 1987, Tom had contacted Phil Katz and simply asked him to pay licensing fees for PK Arc and PK Zark. But Katz simply refused.
Phil Katz pretty much told us to get lost. Said his was a completely original work, had absolutely nothing to do with anything that we had ever done. It was just he and his mom came up with it sitting around the kitchen table. No resemblance. All purely coincidental.
And so, with this going nowhere, SEA went down the only route which was left open to them. In a bid to protect both their intellectual property and their income, during May 1988, they would sue Katz for trademark and copyright infringement. Now, when you're writing code, you tend to leave comments in the source code, so that when you or someone else takes a look at it, they can quickly identify which parts are responsible for what. It was these comments which offered perhaps the most damning evidence that Katz had simply stolen the source code.
Fundamentally, when you looked at the code, it was exact, including the spelling errors. Because my brother wrote some of that code too, and he can't spell to save his life. The spelling errors were exactly the same.
He had made no effort to remove them whatsoever, and Tom and Andy's comments, including spelling mistakes, remained littered through the PK Arc code. Given that shareware can generally be copied, but can't be used or resold in other shareware offerings, this should have been a cut and shut case. But it quickly emerged that this wasn't a war of right or wrong, it was now a war of perception, of propaganda, and the BBS community quickly turned against SEA, with PK Ware perceived to be the poor little guy.
And of course, everybody was behind Phil Katz at that time because he was the little guy, and SEA was the big brother corporation that nobody wanted to deal with.
But it was like a David and Goliath thing is how it struck me.
And all the systems were out there. Everybody was pushing to not purchase C's software and stand behind Phil Katz.
This was despite both companies being very family-based business models of a very similar size, and if anything, Phil now making more money than SEA. In an interview with PC Week, Katz stated, "We're a small company, any kind of litigation is a drain." But the anger wasn't solely from the perception of attacking the little guy. There was anger that SEA was trying to retroactively declare ARC a closed and proprietary format. Of course, it was, but the means to which it felt like a community asset worked very much against them. A news group message from Keith B. Peterson, sent on the 14th of June 1988, seemed to both rally and vocalize people's feelings. "This is really incredible. SEA is suing Phil Katz, the author of PK ARC. I am so angry about this that I am deleting all copies of SEA's ARC program. It's time to send in your support to Phil for his vastly superior archiving program. I am sending my check today in an amount greater than the donation he suggests. His program is free for non-commercial use. Keith Peterson, maintainer of the CPM and MS-DOS archives at Simtel 20. It's clear that SEA were not looking to destroy PK Ware here. Going forward, they just wanted to draw a distinct line in the sand between right and wrong. They wanted the facts to be made clear, but in doing so, they had made the PR blunder of coming across as the aggressive party and shot themselves in the foot. And so on the 2nd of August 1988, they agreed a settlement with Katz. Katz would pay $22,500 for past royalty payments and $40,000 for expense reimbursements. Going forward, he would also pay a 6.5% royalty fee of all revenue received for ARC-compatible programs. After this, PK Ware would release one final version of PK ARC and PK Zark, renamed to PK Pack and PK Unpack, before abandoning them and concentrating on a different compression format. This format would be the ZIP format, released in 1989, with the programs PK ZIP and PK Unzip released to support it. Shortly after creating PK ZIP, Katz published the appnote.txt specification, which documented the ZIP file format and declared that it would always be free for competing software to implement. If you look at the specification, the concepts aren't really that far away from the ARC file format, but of course it no longer infringed on copyright. The support Katz already had, combined with this, meant ZIP quickly became the compression standard to go to for both bulletin boards and Microsoft DOS-based PCs. This led PK Ware to become a multi-million dollar company. Although Phil's adamant opposition to Microsoft Windows meant PK Ware itself would miss out on being the first company to bring compression to the Windows platform.
And what else does it do? A couple more tricks, I think.
Well, we have several data compression-related products. One of our newer products is a data compression library, which allows any application programmer to integrate our compression technology into their application program.
SEA never did recover from the bad PR they received during this process, and would be sold to a Japanese firm in 1992, drawing a line under the whole endeavor for Tom and Andy. Okay, let's discuss modern day coding and Skillshare, because they've been a great sponsor for this channel, and I've enjoyed lots of courses, including Ali Abdal's Productivity Masterclass. I mean, how do you think I've done so many videos recently? But one I really like is Creative Coding, Animating SVG with Simple CSS by Aga Naplocha. And not just because of this keyboard. One part of web development I never really got a handle on was animation, but here it's laid out elegantly, simply, and in a way you'd expect from Skillshare and all their courses. Skillshare is giving away 2 free months of premium membership to the first 1,000 people who click on the link in the description box to help you explore your creativity, and then it's only around $10 a month. However, this isn't a happy tale for anyone involved. Phil Katz had always been troubled through his life, but during the mid-90s would descend further into alcoholism and ended up dying on the 14th of April 2000 in a Milwaukee hotel room at the age of just 37. Also sadly, Andy Foray would pass away in 2014 after a long battle with melanoma. As for Tom, he and his wife would set up S4Net, a local internet services provider for the Eastern Shore, providing a much less complicated occupation than what the world of bulletin board systems had brought. PK Ware was originally sold in 2001 to investment bank Grace Matthews and continued to run, led by George Haddix, before being sold to Ascent Solutions. Still specializing in data compression, they moved into data protection and encryption in 2009, which they continue to specialize in today. Of course, most of us use zip files now on a daily basis, in email, downloads, even just compressing files on our desktop, whereas the ARC format is mostly a distant memory. I suggest you go and watch the Bbs documentary to get a deeper understanding of the whole world of bulletin boards if you haven't already. The links are provided below. Thanks for watching. Have a great evening.